Some 5 managers and supervisors who were picked up by the Data Protection Commission will be made to face the law. According to the commission, the matter has been transferred to the Attorney General's office after they were arrested Monday afternoon, and prosecution is expected to begin. Meanwhile, the Data Protection Commission says it has engaged all defaulting companies about the need to register and be licensed with the commission before undertaking the exercise to prosecute them.
Many channels through yourselves, the media partnership, newspapers, seminars, webinars, roadshows, workshops throughout the period between 2018 and now, we've taken practical steps to reach out to data controllers, cooperate with them, engage them, write letters explaining their duties and responsibilities to them. Whenever a defaulter comes on our radar, we take steps to explain to them. Again, we have offered training courses, certifications to put professionals in the Ghana ecosystems. As at today, we've trained almost 1,000 professionals, and we've placed them in key public sector institutions and in some private sector, the large private sector institutions, to help them build and implement their internal privacy programs. There's a framework by which you can ensure that you are being accountable to us, the public. We teach them, we give them the tools, and we support them to do that. So recently we put out a public notice, and before the public notice we had notified about 250 non-complying data controllers by letter, quoting the section 56 of our act, saying that if you are a person who is supposed to comply, you have failed to do it, you are breaching the act, you're failing and non-complying with the law.
All right, joining me, my colleague, Isaac Atase Nyako. He's joined us from the Joy Business Newsroom. And we had a discussion about this morning and wondering, really, if individuals understand what is happening and are concerned about it. What do you think?
Well, thank you, Darren, for having me. Well, when we talk about data, you know, protection, I think it comes in various facets. First of all, you may want to look at, let's say, business to business, when, for instance, a regulator, let's say BOG, can, you know, enforce this or these directives on their entities under the regulator. So, for instance, all financial institutions, fintechs under BOG, it's incumbent on BOG to be able to ensure that, you know, data of customers are protected and are not used for, you know, things which will more or less favor the bank against the individual. You know, also you can look at institutions like the Electoral Commission, you can even look at the NIA, where they sometimes contract third parties. So for instance, the NIA can contract third parties or a third party in the collection of data, for instance, and also in the processing of data. So all of these parties in this process do have some form of responsibility in making sure that data of individuals, data of citizens are protected. And so it more or less comes, you know, in a sort of like a two-way street thing. But what we are looking at, or what the Data Protection Agency has been doing since yesterday, is to clamp down on businesses who are flouting these laws. So we look at the individual-to-business relationship where, for instance, I go to a bank, I give them my credentials, and when I breach or I flout the terms, they decide to put out my details, my picture, my name, my buyer details, and they think or they believe that doing that will enforce people who breach contracts to be able to pay. And so this is what has been happening. But it expands. You can even look at the internet, and especially now with emerging technologies and all of that, and what people are doing. But Darrell, I always say that when it comes to data and data protection, the individual is key. Yeah. We walk into places and people ask us to give our bio details, our phone numbers, our contacts. We need to be able to ask questions. Who is handling these information we are putting out, and what is it being used for? Yeah, in that era where data is one of the most expensive things, if not the expensive, you know, commodity. And so everybody is trying to, you know, fight for, you know, a piece of the pie, as it were.
And just in a minute, we know that government plans to make Ghana a data hub with the building of several data centers. So what risk does the internet pose?
Well, it's a very critical issue here, and if we remember a couple of years ago with the Cambridge Analytica incident with Meta, then it was Facebook where, you know, it was sued after they realized that a part of the data of users of Facebook, not only Facebook and but other tech companies as well, have been sued over the past years, you know, were sold out to other companies, and Meta made lots of money from these data. And so when it comes to the internet, when it comes to data, it's very critical. Then again, the positives. Now let's look at this. If Ghana is successful, imagine if we had a database of about the history of, you know, who since or for the past 50 years, for instance, first of the number of seeds, the yields, the number of farmers over a period of 50 years. Imagine what we can do. Now, with emerging technologies like AI, which is largely based or largely driven by data, it's very important that we are able to, you know, keep some of these or start collecting some of these from entities, businesses, government especially, to be able to build some of these trusted platforms. However, that's where the risk lies, because then it's open and anybody can hack, and other tech companies can also buy into it.
We've got to go. Isaac, thank you so much. Catch you in the newsroom.